This video is brought to you by Atmo. In a recent video, I covered how air source heat pumps are getting much better in the cold, but in my new house, I decided not to go with one. Instead, I went with the more expensive option, a geothermal heat pump. So why did I decide it was a better option to drill into the earth 400 feet at more cost for my new home? Well, I'll run through that, but there's also a few other things I kind of went a little nuts on in my house that are worth touching on too, like smart electric panels, a crazy home network, and a lot more. Let's get into the current state of my net zero energy home. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. So it's been a while since my last update on my home build. And if you haven't seen the last video where I showed the progress of assembling my factory built home on my property, you should really check that out. I'll put the link in the description. But to catch everyone up really quick, I'm building a new super energy efficient home with the goal of being net zero energy, meaning that my home will generate as much energy as it uses over the course of a year. And to hit that goal, the first step is to build something that's going to be super energy efficient. Now, during the time period that's been since the last video, a lot of things have been happening at once. From my geothermal system, getting the metal roof on, roughing in the electrical and the plumbing, and by the time this video goes out, the drywall will finally be done. Now, my wife and I have gone a little nuts in what we're putting into the house. I mean, who am I kidding? It's me pushing this, not my wife. But I keep joking with her that I feel like John Hammond building out Jurassic Park.
Spared no expense.
We spared no expense.
Spared no expense.
Spared no expense.
I just hope I don't come to regret that like John Hammond did. Now, one of the big updates I wanted to run through was my geothermal system and why I decided to go that route. It shouldn't be a surprise that I'm all in on heat pumps. I've put out quite a few videos on why we should heat pump all the things, and my house is no different. I'm going to get into a lot more detail in a future video, breaking down the costs and analysis of the system I installed. But the TLDR of why I went with geothermal versus an air source heat pump system, or even a mini split system, came down to efficiency and longevity, not just cost. Getting a geothermal system is typically a lot more expensive than a typical air source heat pump, but there are incentives that bring that cost more in line, but it is still more expensive up front. However, the geothermal system is more efficient and can be tied into my hot water generation, and that combo will save me money and energy long term. This is our forever home, so we're looking to live here for 20 to 30 years, which means we'll be getting our money and quality of life improvements out of the slightly higher upfront cost. It was an interesting experience getting the system designed and seeing it installed. We hired an independent mechanical engineer that had no association with any company to design a system that would meet our goals. We walked through some different options like air source heat pumps, but ultimately we landed on a geothermal system. And yes, this is going to be tied into the smart electrical system, which I'll get to in a little bit. But in the end, we went with the brand Water Furnace. And for full transparency, I do have an arrangement with Water Furnace where they're helping me out with some of the HVAC system, but they have no say over the videos and they've never asked to. In any case, the independent designer we hired calculated that we'd probably need about 25,000 BTU per hour for heating on the coldest days, which is around negative 10 degrees Fahrenheit or negative 23 degrees Celsius, and 15,000 BTU per hour for cooling in summer on the hottest days, which would be around 90 degrees Fahrenheit or 32 degrees Celsius. Ideally, we'd have something around a 2-ton system, but since we ended up going with the Water Furnace Series 7, the smallest available is a 3-ton system. The fact it's a little oversized shouldn't be an issue since it's a variable speed system and can easily run partial load demands. In fact, it might actually help us since it'll be running at lower percentages most of the time, which should make for an even quieter operation. I'll have to live with it to actually find out though. So more on that is going to be coming in a future video down the road. But it's the geothermal well that I was crazy interested to see built out. Before I get to the build out, I'd like to talk about another technology that's been playing a big role in monitoring the air quality in my current home, my new home, and pretty much anywhere else I take it, and that's AtmoTube, a portable air quality sensor by Atmo, who's today's sponsor. I have pretty bad allergies and need to stay on top of the air quality of where I am to avoid issues. For instance, cleaning products can put a lot of harsh chemicals into the air. AtmoTube Pro is a small, very portable air quality monitor that you can carry with you. It monitors everything from volatile organic compounds or VOCs and particulate matter all the way down to PM1, as well as temperature, humidity, and barometric pressure. This is going to be really useful for me as we set up the new house. I'll get immediate alerts if paints or cleaners are giving off VOCs or if there's a high level of pollutants in the air. To make it easy, AtmoTube has a special air quality score. It pairs to the AtmoTube app on your phone over Bluetooth, which is available on both iOS App Store and Google Play Store. There's so many ways this can be useful to monitor the air wherever you are, like going outside on a walk. To get the AtmoTube Pro for yourself, check out the link in the description, and thanks again to Atmo and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to drilling for heat. There are two typical options for a ground loop. The first is a horizontal loop, and the second is a vertical loop. The more affordable horizontal loop is where they dig down ideally 6 to 10 feet over a large area of your yard. Then they put in a single run of tubing in small loops that feeds back to the house and cover it back up. Given the size of my yard and its location, a horizontal loop wasn't the best option for us, so we had to go the more expensive route with a vertical loop. And drilling a vertical well isn't that different from drilling a well for water, but as somebody who's never seen that process in person, I was fascinated by this. Now, the drilling truck was backed into my backyard, and then the crew had to dig down about 5 or 6 feet with a backhoe before they could even start. And I live in New England, and the weather wasn't cooperating the day or two before, and we had a cold snap which froze the ground, so they had to dig out some of the frozen dirt by hand with the help of a jackhammer. Once they got past that, they were able to get the drill set up. And they dug a little trench system that they filled with water and added a material which is usually something like a bentonite additive. It creates the drilling mud. Now, the mud is essential for drilling because it forms a thin film on the walls of the borehole to seal it and prevent water loss while drilling. It also supports the borehole wall to keep it from caving in. And during the drilling process, a drill bit is attached to a long pipe and they keep adding onto it as it goes. After the hole is completed, they feed a closed loop polyethylene pipe into the hole and then fill the hole with grout. Now, the grout is extremely important because it helps to transfer the heat from the surrounding rock and dirt into the tubing and ultimately the fluid inside. In my case, they drilled down about 400 feet and only needed to do one well to support the heating and cooling demands of my HVAC system. Someone else's home might need more wells or deeper wells. And once you get down to about 6 to 10 feet below the surface, the earth becomes a consistent 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 degrees Celsius. That's critical for the efficiency of the heat pump system because no matter what time of year it is, we can always count on having that 50 degrees Fahrenheit to pull heat from in the winter or move heat into during the summer. The exterior air temperature is less of a concern. Again, I'll refer you back to a previous video on how heat pumps work, but by using a compressor, they can boost that heat from 50 degrees Fahrenheit up to comfortable temperatures for your home. If you're curious about the liquid that's going to be pressurized into the tube, it's going to be Environal, which is an alcohol-based antifreeze that makes sure that it won't freeze up in the middle of winter. The well tubing was run towards the house where it connected up to the tubing that had been pre-installed in the foundation and up into the mechanical room. It's in there that you'll find the water furnace system and all the ductwork that feeds the forced air throughout my house. And yes, we went with forced air over something like radiant heat. You can think that was a bad call on my part all you want, but we wanted a system that could both heat and cool. And our home is going to have somewhere around R60 insulation in the attic space and R35 in the walls, as well as triple-paned windows, so it was a little bit overkill for radiant heating. In fact, our mechanical engineer said that we might run into a problem with the house getting too warm because of the low and slow way radiant systems heat homes. The system would shut off when you get close to the ideal temperature, but it continues to go beyond that because of the nature of a radiant system. So in the mechanical room, you can see that the Series 7 is all set up. There's still no power, so it's not running yet. But you can see all of the ductwork runs running throughout the house. And over here, you can see the Renew Air ERV system. And this is probably one of the most critical components of the entire house because of how airtight it is. Homes need to breathe, otherwise CO2 levels would become dangerous. In a typical draft year home, this is partially taken care of by air just naturally forcing its way through all the cracks and holes around the house. With an airtight house and an ERV system, you control how the air enters and exits the house, which gives you some huge advantages. One is that you can recover the heat of the air as it exits the house and exchange that with the cooler air coming into the house and warm it up. The second benefit is for someone like me with pretty bad allergies, I'm controlling how things like pollen work their way into my home and can filter that air before it's mixed into the rest of the house. I'm also working with someone to help design an add-on to my Renew Air ERV to give it smarts for my smart home. It'll allow me to set up more sophisticated automations for how the system ramps up and down. I'll be able to link it into the smart electrical system in new ways, and again, I'll be getting to the electrical system in a bit. The ERV is tied into the same HVAC ductwork to provide that fresh air throughout the entire system. However, there are dedicated ERV air intakes for exhausting stale air outside the house in a few key locations. For instance, there's an ERV intake vent in both bathrooms, in the kitchen near where the stove will be, and near the laundry room. It'll help to pull out excess moisture from the bathrooms and laundry area, as well as cooking fumes near the kitchen. Meanwhile, fresh air will be fed through all of the heating and cooling vents throughout the house. One last note on the geothermal system in the mechanical room is that there'll be a de-superheater that will take excess heat from the geothermal system and hold it as warmed water that feeds into a heat pump water heater from Rheem. Not only is a heat pump water heater one of the more energy-efficient ways to create hot water, but it'll be even more efficient with the pre-warmed water coming from the geothermal system. It's pretty cool. Or hot. And that leads me to the electrical needs of the house. Since I'm going to be all electric for everything and won't have natural gas lines even run to the house, we're trying to optimize our energy usage. The geothermal system, de-superheater, and heat pump water heater are the big ticket items that are helping with that, but there's also what I'm doing with the electrical system itself. Now, if you haven't seen my video on the Span smart electric panel, I actually have one in my current house and I absolutely love the thing. I looked into a few other options for smart panel setups for my new house, but ultimately, because I really love the Span, I decided to stick with it. Now, full transparency again, Span has sponsored previous videos on my channel and they provided the smart panels for my new home, but just like with water furnace, they have no say over anything I say in my videos. My opinions are my own, and I wanted to go with Span again because, again, I love the product. For me though, it was a no-brainer because I've been playing around with integrating my current Span smart panel into the rest of my smart home using Home Assistant. So it all works locally and in my control. It's really slick. Now, I may get into this in a future video if anyone's interested, so let me know. But for my new house, this is going to be the brain of my electrical system. It'll help regulate how my solar panels and batteries work in conjunction with all of the other devices in my house. I'll be able to optimize how and when my EVs charge based on excess solar production, or what happens if the grid goes down to extend the length of time my batteries can provide power. There's a lot I'm going to be able to do, which leads me to the part where you probably say, I think Matt may have lost his mind. I'm sure you're going to be calling that out in the comments. Since I'm all in on smart homes and having devices being able to communicate and optimize my home's energy, I'm installing a really extensive home network, partially for that and partially for my business. There's a whole closet that I've dubbed my networking closet that has, I actually don't remember how many lines come into it. It might be close to 60, 50, I'm not sure. My electrician was teasing me that I've won the crown for the most Ethernet lines he's run into a single house. I also had low voltage lines run to each window to support powered smart shades. I'm going with Lutron for those, but there's other options too. Is it necessary? No. But I'm really excited about it. One of the automations I'm looking forward to experimenting with is automatically dropping the shades depending on the time of day and how bright or warm it's making a room. That should help me control how much energy my HVAC system needs to use. In theory, that should help with cooling costs over the summer and heating costs over the winter, but probably not enough to make it financially worth it, but the convenience and comfort factor is going to be high with this one. I'll be doing some experiments and I'm going to be sharing what I find. I'm also going to have Lutron smart switches throughout the house. I've got Lutron switches throughout my current house, and they're the most rock-solid smart home tech I've ever used. I've never had a problem. So it was another no-brainer for me to put those in the new house as well. Again, ticks the box for convenience and the ability to automate lights to save on energy, but I'll be sharing more details on that later too. And there's going to be wired security cameras I'll be installing around the house, which will record locally. The plan right now is to have Ubiquiti power not only the home network, but also the security camera setup. There's even more I could go into, like the soundproofing insulation that's throughout the house, what I'm doing with my home studio, why I went with the metal roof, the EV charging setup, the garage, and my solar and home battery. That's gonna be end phase, by the way, but let me know what you'd like to hear more about. I am planning dedicated videos around my solar and home battery setup, the Span setup, the HVAC system once it's up and running, and I've had time to experience it, so there's so much to share. So jump into the comments and let me know what you'd like to see. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined, where I'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video, and a big welcome to new producer, Eric Toller. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.